Hello everyone, I am Ibrahim from Trident Infosol, Reliability Engineer. So today we are going to see the topic strategies and methods for reliability, availability, maintainability and safety. So before jumping into the tool, we'll just see what is the agenda for today. Traditional method. So how difficult it was to make a reliability prediction, reliability analysis, starting from the MTBF value to the fault tree analysis. So how they were facing the issues, so that we will be seeing in the traditional methods. Next comes the difficulty in identifying the reliability, how difficult it was to identify. Even after the traditional methods, we would have gone, or we would have got some standards, we would have got some formulas, we would have got some applications to develop it. Even then, how it was difficult to identify the reliability. So then comes to the RAM Commander solutions. RAM Commander is a software from ALD where they provide solutions for this reliability analysis. So what are all the steps and procedures they follow to overcome the reliability difficulties and how to achieve the reliability for a system or a product. Next is strategies. So how we are following the strategy to do the analysis for the reliability. So that we will be seeing in the strategies. Next, RAM Commander modules overview. So what are all the modules we have? Actually, reliability has certain segments wherein we will be having a prediction, we will be having the failure analysis, we will be having the reliability analysis, and we will be having the maintainability analysis. So how it has been segmented, we will be seeing about it. Next, where and all we can use the RAM Commander modules. So I was saying about the modules that are available in the RAM Commander. So where all these modules will suit from the concept level to the face-off level in the industry, that we'll be seeing on it. Next, what are all the methodologies? What are all the methodologies, which means that what are all the standards we follow to identify the reliability prediction, that we'll be seeing in the FR and MTBF prediction methods. So next comes to the FMECA, FTA, reliability block diagram, derating analysis. So these all modules follow certain standards. They will be having certain standards. For example, MIL-1629A procedure standard, this one, formats are there. So likewise, so many methods are there. We will be seeing about those methods also. And then features overview. RAM Commander has a specific features. So what are all those features? We will be seeing about it. And what is the benefit of using this software? And what is the ALD software solutions, like what are all the other softwares we have, that also we'll be seeing in this. So now we'll talk about the traditional method. So traditional method is nothing but before standardization. So I wanted to say that TR1100, reliability stress analysis for equipments, for electronic equipments, which is the standard that has been identified for first time, wherein they were doing the analysis in this. I think so this is developed in 1956, and then slowly it developed to MIL Handbook 217 in 1959, then slowly which has a single point failure of 0.4 failure per million hours, which means that a single valued failure rate was indicative of a fact that accuracy and science were of less concern than standardization. Then they slowly develop to the MIL Handbook 217A. Then they come across the MIL Handbook 217B. So this is how they were developing the standards at the time of 1950s to 1970s. So next, they pitched into Excel sheet calculation. So what is the difficulty in Excel sheet calculation is when a designer or a document analyzer, where if that person or a group of people, if they unknowingly deleted any cells, for example, a bill of material will be consisting of the serial number, part number, this one, reference designators, there are other parameters also. So when they unknowingly deleted some important parameters like current stress ratio, power stress ratio, or the package type or anything from that particular Excel sheet, if any cells are missing, then your reliability analysis will not be accurate. So there will be some issues. Next, come to the MTBF and MTTF, which means that the mean time to failure, could address the flat portion of the traditional bottom curve, which means that it has a constant failure, and there was no failure reliability. So now it's the time to move on. So it's the traditional method is completed. Now we have certain standards and we have certain applications to do the analysis. What is that? We'll see now. Difficulty in identifying the reliability, wherein I pointed out here, is even the software has been developed, but even the data are slow, or we are doing an Excel sheet calculation, but even what happens is data are out of date. What happens is now currently it is 2018. So wherein I have a data of 2010 or 2000 or 1998 or 1999, where that part is not absolute, but there will be some changes the manufacturer would have made some changes in that particular component. Maybe they would have changed the type of the material what they have used, or they would have changed the quality of that particular component. So now when you are not using any software, what happens is you will not be getting the update of that particular component. So when you are having this software, there will be a continuous updation when they newly release the patch up files. So data will be out of date. Next is equipment removal and part failures are not equal, which means that often field removed parts are retested as operational and the cause of failure is never determined. That is the one thing. Next is many assembly failures are not component related, which is that due to an error in socketing, calibration or instrument reading, due to the improper interconnection of the component during a higher level assembly process. So if you have any meter which is reading the data from your system, wherein that meter itself is wrong, where it is reading an inaccurate data, or that meter has some bug in it. So the data whatever you get it from the meter, that you will be taking for the reliability calculation, wherein it is not a correct value, so the reliability analysis will be wrong. So we have to check out first whether the reading meter is correct or not. Then interconnection of the components, whether the components or the system or the level of assembly, the assembly level is getting interconnected properly or not. That is the second thing. So failures of component is not always due to the component intrinsic mechanism, which means that an overstress event after installation. So what I mean to see here is actually component failure is not because of only the component or the internal parameters of the component. Even when you do after the installation you give overstress to the components, even that may cause a failure. Latent damage during storage, handling or installation after the shipment. So during the shipment there may be a physical damage for it, or during the storage time you keep the component for nearly 4 or 5 years, wherein it may get to the open air, or there will be some other problem that may happen to the components that may also create a failures for the component. Improper assembly to a system, there is no proper assembly. Choice of wrong component for use in the system by the installer or by the designer. So for a fixed freeze design, the component should be picked out correctly, then your reliability will be good. So to continue with the slide, electronics do not fail at constant rate as predicted by the models. So they will not fail at a constant rate, there will be some variations also. The reliability prediction models are based upon the industry average failure rate, which are neither by the vendor or nor device specific. So this is one of the difficulties which you face. A traditional reliability prediction approaches can produce what are likely to be highly variable assessment. So which, for example, for this point I can say an example. If you take a component which is working on ground benign with 40 degree temperature, wherein you are getting a failure rate of 700 fits to 4 lakh fits. For example, you are getting this much of variation in the fit, wherein your field failure rate is different, wherein your predicted value is different, and you have done the calculation manually where that is different. Or in the field failure rate itself, you are getting multiple failure rates for the particular component or a system. So how to get an accurate failure rate for this? So we have a module called a variable analysis, where you can collect all the field failure data. For 500 hours, what is the failure rate? For 1000 hours, what is the failure rate? For 2000 hours, what is the failure rate? Likewise, continuously you can collect the failure rates. Then, when after collecting it, just feed it into the software, and we have the distribution for it. You just do the analysis, wherein you will get an accurate failure rate for that particular component. So, wherein if the software is not there, or if you don't have any perfect methodology, then it will be very difficult to identify this reliability. Next is, the traditional prediction methods have been found to be questionable. Why it is questionable? Because model do not predict the field failures. That is one thing. Cannot be used for comparative purpose. Yes, obviously it can be, it cannot be compared for that. Present misleading trends and relations. So whatever the component is recommended by the design engineer, that has to be faded. We should not go with the component which is of the less price, and we should not go with the different manufacturers, or even if after going to the different manufacturers, we have to see the parameters are same which the design engineer has given. So everything has to be mapped. So based on that, we have to do the reliability. So now we will be seeing what RAN commander can give the solution for this. So when we say a good reliability, everyone will be talking about this physics of failure. What is this physics of failure? It's nothing but identifying the failure rate and giving the overstress to the component, identify what is the failure rate, and giving a different temperature, environment and vibration conditions and humidity. By giving all these parameters or all these conditions to a system and identify what is the failure rate. So when you do for a system with a single environment with the temperature and humidity and vibration, you want to check for different environment for the same project, wherein the software will help you out, because one time you just want to work on it, and the next time you just change the environment temperature, it will automatically, the failure rates will get varied to its environment temperature and the vibration conditions. Then comes the duty cycle. So what is this duty cycle? Duty cycle, nothing but if a system is continuously running for 12 hours per day, wherein few components will not be used, or it will not be in the operating state for 12 hours. It will be for 4 hours or 3 hours. For example, we can say that cooling fan or a switch which is not continuously operated. So for those components, we should be knowing about the duty cycle, and then we have to feed the value for it. So based on that, we can get the reliability data. Then failure causing stresses. So we have a derating analysis, where you can give the overstress value, then you can identify what is the cause of this particular failure. Maybe the over voltage is, or the over current is the cause of this failure. Next, root cause analysis for failure mechanism. So root cause analysis, nothing but the overall system is getting failed. Why? Because of which component my overall system is getting failed. So we have a type called the root cause analysis. Then we have failure modes, different failure modes for a component. There will be, because in different standards have different failure modes. So based on that particular standard, which application you are working, your system is going to work on, based on that your failure modes will get varied. So this all is called physics of failure. When I specifically talk about it, we can say that Japan, Taiwan, Singapore, US and UK, like these people came out of the traditional ways of reliability analysis, and now they follow reliability assessment techniques that are based on the root cause analysis of failure of mechanism, failure modes, stress values, etc. So this approach, what we called as physics of failure. So what this physics of failure have done is, actually it has proven the prevention, detection, correction and failure associated with the designs. Next is actually updated database. So RAN commander has nearly 5 lakh plus components inbuilt in the software. We have the database of it, wherein we have collected the data from all the OEMs, all the manufacturers. So what all the data is required for a component is available with us. So we have the mapping option, where in the bill of material, if the part number is there, directly it will be mapped to the software and it will predict the failure rate value. Next is, latent failures during storage can be identified. So earlier days in the traditional method, what happened is when you are having a system in a shelf life, when it is not getting operated for 2 hours, for 2 years or 3 years, it is very difficult to identify the reliability. So now we have a module called non-operating, where it follows five different standards. I'll be listing out the standards in further slides. So those standards will help you out to identify what is the failure rate when a system is in a storage condition. Then the software has other options called rule check, which means that zero failure rate component. For example, if you have thousands of components, or we can say we can take some numbers like 587 components are available. Now you don't know that whether you have done the analysis for all the components. So what happened is, this particular software will help you out to identify which component is not calculated. So that is one advantage. Products parameter mismatch, which means that I am taking a component, for example resistor, where it is following only Jan or Jan TX, wherein I try to make that component with SPRC as a C class as a quality, where it is not correct. So this mismatch of it will be identified by the software, and it will throw you an error dialog box. Other thing I can say is we have a mechanical libraries also, like in PRD 95, 2011 and 2016. So what happens is few standards will support few components, and few components it won't support. So it will throw you the message, or it will throw you a dialog box saying that this particular component cannot be analyzed under this standard. That is one advantage. And warning on standardization. So warning on standard is nothing but I can say an example for this. Like if you take a component with under Telcodia issue 4, wherein the particular component, if it will not work under 30 degree temperature, it will throw you a warning that this particular component cannot work under 30 degree temperature. It should be more than a 30 degree temperature. So like these warnings will be popped out. Next is, proper maintenance could address the wear out life limit portion of the bottom curve, which means that maintainability, how effectively we are doing the maintenance. Corrective maintenance is there, and preventive maintenance is there, and we have reliability centered maintenance, where we can do the procedural form of reliability centered maintenance. And spare part optimization, what all the spare parts should be delivered to the customer during the dispatch time. When we talk about this, when we were talking about this reliability, what is this RAM commander options available, so how we followed, what are the strategies we followed for doing this? Find out reliability critical item to do effective maintenance, which means that reactive to proactive. Like in while doing the prediction, I can identify which component is contributing highest failure rate. And when I do failure mode effect criticality analysis, I can identify which component is having very highest critical, which component is a very highest critical component, which is very severe component, I can say, in other words. So based on this strategies, I can identify, okay, this particular component is very critical. And second is, treat equipment as it was designed to be treated. For example, you take some, I'll take this FMEA as an example, like failure mode effect analysis, where you have certain procedures to follow, like you have MIL 1629A format for it, and you will be having a failure modes, certain failure modes for it, where a design engineer will give the recommended action. Okay, this is the action to be taken if this particular failure mode happens. And that action will be carried out by the maintenance people or the production people, then it will be rectified. So there is some procedure to follow. So that is what we are mentioning here. Even as a reliability centered maintenance also follows the same thing. Like it will be having a procedure, like whether this component has to be maintained in so and so condition, is it significant or not significant, whether the failure of this component is hidden or it is not hidden. So it is a freezed procedure, so we have to follow those procedures. Next, teamwork, which is there in the FMEA, which means that we have done the analysis, like severity, occurrence and detection has been identified, where the team member we'll be having a different experts, like expert 1, expert 2 and expert 3. Three different experts will give their suggestions. They will vote like this will be my severity occurrence and detection value, and the second expert will give his own ideas, and third experts will give his own idea. So it will be calculated as a mean, and a single SOD value will be taken as a mean, and that will be treated for the FMEA. So this is one of the options. So wherein this is the strategy what we follow to do FMEA, RCM, and then teamwork, and we have for FMECA and RBD, for everything the strategies is getting followed up. Know your maintenance procedure frequency. So what is the procedure frequency we are doing it? So reliability centered maintenance frequency optimization, restoration factor and PM summary. So for example, we can take an example of maintenance. I want 99% or 98% of reliability. For doing 98% of to achieve 98% of reliability, how much frequency or what frequency I should attain? Whether I have to attain in the frequency of 10 hours or 10 years or 5 years. So how I have to do the maintenance, whether it in a quarterly basis or half yearly basis or yearly basis, or how many hours I have to work. Hours will be converted to the years, or quarterly wise or half yearly wise, it will be converted to it. That is not a big thing here. So what is the main thing is, for 98% of reliability, how many intervals, frequencies I have to do the maintenance. So that can be calculated by using the software. No more failure modes. Define compensating prevention to eliminate them. So we have to know the failure modes of the component, maximum failure modes of the component. So why we have to know the maximum failure modes is, okay, this component is having this much of failure modes. So we are eliminating these many failure modes to bring that component from a highest critical level list to a lower critical level list, which means that it is under the critical level. The severity is not so high for this component. So what we have to do is we have to eliminate the failure modes. So these are all the strategies we are following in the software to identify a better and best reliability. So this is what I was saying in the previous slide, that modules overview, how the modules will be looking like. You can see the reliability prediction, which has that operating mode, non-operating mode, derating and stress analysis, and reliability analysis, which has reliability block diagram, Markov analysis, mission profile, and maintainability analysis, which will be having spare part optimization, reliability centered maintenance and maintenance prediction, and failure analysis, which means that which it will be having failure mode effect criticality analysis, fault tree analysis, event tree analysis, and process FMEA and design FMEA. So these are all the modules available. So now we will see where all these modules will be applicable for our industry, from the concept level to phase of level. So during the concept level, MTBF part count method. So parts count method will follow only the style of the component and the quality of the component. I won't give any stress values for this, which means that before doing a design, I will be doing a pre-designing work, which means that I am doing the concept level where I won't give any stress parameter to the component. I am just say that these are all the components I am going to use for designing a project. So during that stage, I can identify what is the failure rate of the system. Second is design phase. So now I have freeze the design. Now I have to know what is the stress parameters for the component using parts count method. That is what here it is highlighted. My MTBF parts stress method. Sorry. So here the parts stress method will give you the stress parameters. We have to give the stress parameters wherein, as I said, we have 5 lakh plus component library. It will automatically recognize, or it will identify the part number available in the bill of material given by the customer, and it will take the part number map from the database which we have, and it will give you the failure rate. Next, during the industry which is doing the design, they can do reliability block diagram also, wherein you can identify what is the reliability of the system and what is the availability of your system. Next comes the design FMEA, which means that design failure mode effect analysis. So when the design engineer designs it, he will be knowing what are all the failure modes may happen to the component or a system which he is designing. So he has to give the FMEA report, which should be consisting of severity occurrence and detection, where it will give you the actual RPN value, which means that risk priority number, and he will be giving the recommended action. So that recommended action has to be taken care by the maintenance or the production people. Then it has to be solved out, and the resultant RPN value will be there. So resultant RPN value should be less than the actual RPN value. Then there will be a good strategical level of doing the analysis. Then FMECA, which means that failure mode effect criticality analysis. Even the design people who does it, they can do it, because FMECA has different standards like FMD 97, Senelec, AREMA, IEC. There are different standards. So each and every component will have a failure modes. So when they are designing it, they can also assign with the specific to the standard what are all the failure modes. For that failure mode, you can identify the failure rate also, so that you can identify what is the criticality of the component, so that you can identify which component is very critical in my system. So in design phase, you can identify all these stages. So company who does a design process, they can go with all these modules. Manufacturing industries. So when industry is following a manufacturing process, they have process FMEA, process failure mode effect analysis. So what is this? What it can do is, actually I can take an example of PCB board, where you want to do a soldering, where you have done an over soldering, or you have done only less soldering to it. It's a process failure. Or you have placed a IC in a opposite way, where a pin 1 is fabbed with the pin 14. So you have just twisted that component, or you have just misplaced that component. That is a process failure. A drill hole. You have made a big hole, or you would have made a small hole for inserting a component. That is a process failure. So here also the severity, occurrence and detection and RPN plays a role. So the process person who does it, he will be knowing what are all the procedures to be taken care of, and he will be feeding the report, and that will be taken care of by the production and the maintenance people. And in the testing phase, reliability block diagram, why it is useful. So after a system gets failed, it will be going for a testing, or when a new design is completed, it will be going for testing, and they will be checking what is the reliability for this 90%. So they will be testing, okay, fine, this particular 90% is getting achieved or not. So for that, the reliability block diagram will be useful in the testing phase. And faulty analysis. What is the cause of this particular system failure? So to identify that, faulty analysis will be there to identify the root cause. And what is other, in other words, we can say it as a root cause analysis. Okay, this particular component is the cause of my overall system failure. And then the ETA is available in testing. Then operational maintenance. So in maintenance, MTTR, we will be getting a mean time to repair value. So which means that for removing a component, when a system is, or when a component is getting repaired, how much time it will take to repair a component or a system. Whether we want to repair the system, or we want to repair a component, or we have to replace the component itself. So how much time it will take? We will be getting, so the output will be MTTR value, how much hours it will take to repair a component or a system. Then spare part optimization. Spare part optimization is nothing but when you are designing a system for the first time, and your overall system is about 15 years of life or 10 years of life. So you, when you want to deliver that overall system to a customer, and you identify one of the component is very critical, we can take a switch as an example. Your system is running for 10 years, wherein your switch is having only 2.5 years or 3 years of life. So because of that switch, your system should not stop, because when you want to run a system, you want to for a daily basis, you want to switch on the system. So that switch should not be a big problem. So we have to identify, the tool will identify, not we have to, tool will identify which is very critical component in my overall bill of material. So if that switch is very highest critical component, it will say that 3 or 4 switches should be dispatched with the overall system, so that the production will not stop. It will run continuously. Your reliability will be for 90%, or you can say the availability of the system will be for 98% or 90%. So the spare part optimization will calculate for with respect to the percentage which we give for reliability and availability. For 90%, I want the reliability of the system or availability of the system. So it will see in the MTBF value which component is very critical. It will go to the FMEC and see which component is very critical. okay, this component is very critical, based on that failure rate it will throw number of components should be dispatched to the customer along with the delivery of the component. So this is available, that is one option in the FMEA. So next is process FMEA. So here, when a system is getting failed, when a service engineer is coming for doing a service for the components, so he has to follow the procedures what the process engineer has given. So for that, FMEA plays a role here. Next, come to the safety. So once everything is completed, your system is done, okay, everything is done, it is come to the production, it is in the phase of level. So we have to see whether the system is safe or not. So we have certain standards for analyzing the safety. Here also we have to identify the FMECA, failure mode effect criticality analysis, which component is very critical. For doing this analysis, first and foremost thing is we have to identify what is the failure rate of the component and the system. So for doing that analysis, we follow these methodologies. For operating, we have nearly 30 plus, like starting from Altel, British Telecom, HRD5 and FITS, IEC, Handbook 2 and 7 plus, HRD5 telecommunication and MIL handbook. MIL 2 and 7 2P stress count and 1P 2P count and Telcodia issues like 1, 2, 3, 4 and Siemens ANSYS for operating. And for mechanical, we have NPRD 95, 98, 2011 and 2016. And for non-operating, we have GPRD, MIL 2 and 7, OneDraft like RADAC TR85 and reliability toolkit. So these are all the standards or methods which we follow to identify the basic failure rate and the overall failure rate of the system. So these are the other modules which follows the methods or the standards. Like for derating, we have MIL standard 1547, and for maintainability we have MIL 472 procedure 5A, and the FMEA will follow AIAG and QS 9000 formats, and FMECA will follow MIL standard 1629A procedure. Likewise, we have for FMECA also will follow certain standards like FMD 97, FMD 2013, AREMA, NSWC 11, IEC 62380. And for safety, we have SAE ARP 4761 and MIL standard 882. So these many other standards are available in different methods. So what are all the features? What is the features overview of this particular thing is, it has, as I said, it has 5 lakh plus components available in the database in the software. And import file from external application, like for doing the analysis in this particular product, we will be exporting some input as a BOM, bill of material. Like it can be an Excel sheet, or it can be an ASCII format, or it can be an netlist format, or it can be an output of SAP and ERP. And once it is getting imported, we have automatic mapping. So automatically, whatever the bill of material is getting, whatever the call rows we have given in the bill of material, like serial number, reference designator, stress values, part numbers, quantities, everything will be automatically mapped. So when you first time we have to map it, so that will be saved as a script. We can name our own name. For example, we take a company called ABC. So that ABC will be saved as a script. So next time when you are importing the bill of material, it will automatically map your names with respect to the bill of material. Then copying data from between project and the fields. So you can open multiple projects at the same time. It is not that you have to work on single project. Maybe you would creating a project in 2018, a new project wherein it is some reference of 2011 project. So you don't want to open two different softwares, or you don't want to open two different system and compare your project and what all the components are available. In the same software, in the same window, you can open multiple projects and you can just verify it. And multi-user capabilities. So when you have a network license, multiple person can work on a single project. When, for example, Mr. A is working on MTBF, Mr. B will be working on FMEA, Mr. C will be working on RBD. So multiple person can work at the same time in a project. So multi-windowing. Multi-windowing, nothing but, as we saw, there were so many modules available in the software where you can open all the modules at the same time, or whichever the modules you require, you can just make it. For example, I want to create a reliability block diagram with the help of this MTBF values. I can open the MTBF value operating condition page. In other side, I can make the this reliability block diagram window, and I can just work on both the things. And next is these are all the other features like variable access privilege, product tree presentation, operating data grids, automatic part number recognition, automatic tree options, automatic data validation and correction, automatic creation of fault tree, RBD, FMEA and FMECA module. So like another headed point I can say is here is actually fault tree can import from other softwares also like Ayala. There are so many other FTA softwares available to create FTA. Even we can just import it inside the RAM commander software. For FMEA, you can even create it in the Excel sheet or you can create it in a MS Office, Word. In that, from that Word, you can easily import it inside the software. Even we can also do like that. And fault tree can be created from reliability block diagram, FMEA, FMECA. So from reliability block diagram, what FTA you get is system level fault tree analysis. From FMEA also you get the system level. From RBD also you'll get the system level. From FMECA you get, which means that failure mode effect criticality analysis, a component level. So a component level fault tree analysis you can get it. Wherein in fault tree analysis, I think so most of the people will be knowing AND gate, OR gate, basic event, undeveloped event, repairable, non-repairable. There are so many classifications available in FTA. All these options are available in the software. Next is FMECA. As I said, it will be following multiple standards like FMD 97, 2013, NAREMA, IEC 62380, SENELEC. So different standards will have, for the same component, different standards or different applications will have different failure modes. That will be highlighted here. And next is same, it is, as I said, it will be having, the FTA will be having AND, OR, or basic, undeveloped, house and external, NOR, NAND, OR, XOR, K out of N, priorities of N, SEQ and SPAS and negative gates, etc. For the convenient product tree tools, we have search option, global change, copy between the fields. For example, I can say a good example for this is actually you have completed your project in the software which consists of nearly 600 components and you don't want to work on with MIL standard, you just want to work on with IEC. You can just globally change that particular standard, and based on that particular environment standard, your failure rates will get varied. And other example is all your overall project you have developed with 24 hours continuously running operating condition duty cycle, wherein my system is not running for full 24 hours, it is running only for 8 hours, which means that 0.8 I have to make for the overall system. So I don't want to go for each and every component to make that component as 0.8. globally I can change it to 0.8, 0.6 or whatever the time I require. It will reflect in all the components in a single shot. So that is one of the advantage. Likewise, we have so many options. These are all the specific pointed options available in the RAM commander. So what is the benefit we get out of it? We get a product lifetime and feedback of result into a design yield and benefits. We can design, we can identify the problem areas in the system. We can get knowledge of spare parts and planning. We can just plan it. Okay, what these are the spare parts, whether it is very costly or it is not that so costly. And we can eliminate or evaluate overall reliability. It's very easy to evaluate or identify what is the reliability of my system. And I can identify the reliability is improving with each version. So I have multiple versions. We'll be releasing the multiple versions. And if you're doing a revision of that particular design multiple times, you can identify whether your reliability is getting increased or it is going on decreasing. And you'll be having a longer predictive life, fewer field failures, lower warranty cost, and you have better customer relationship. So everyone does the reliability analysis to have a better customer relationship. So once you deliver very good product to a customer, you will be getting a repetitive business. So wherein the reliability will give you a best result out of it, because before you start the production, you have to know what is the reliability of the product, what all the components I should use in my design so that my reliability of the system will will be very much good, so that my product will not have failures for a long years. So wherein you get a very more customers where your business will go on increase. So next is the upcoming webinars. Their upcoming webinars will be on FailWeb, which is a dynamic failure analysis tool, which is a web-based tool where, for example, we have a multiple, if a company is having multiple branches in different domains, in different places, where they will be giving you the field failure rates of, like we have acquired this many failure rates from this customer, we have acquired field failure rate from this particular base customer. So you can acquire, you can collect all those data and you can put it in the FailWeb, where a reliability engineer will collect those data and he will be doing the analysis for it, and there will be a corrective action team where what is the error and how it has to be rectified, and again it will be given back to the FailWeb and it will be given to the service engineers, so they will follow it. Likewise, FailWeb will help you out to identify the dynamic failure analysis. Next is sneak circuit analysis. So what is, which particular path is very much critical or which is having a sneak in your schematic design can be identified by using this CAT. And then comes to the design lifecycle cost. What is the project cost? I can easily say that, we can also say that what is the overall project cost from the raw material to the end of the project? What will be the cost? And what will be the cost if it is in the same kind of design, if it is again made in 2020 or 2025, what will be the cost of this particular project can be identified by using the DLCC. So here I want to highlight on FailWeb because now because Frakas is one of the main people who work on reliability mainly look into the Frakas, because it is a dynamic failure analysis tool where it is a web-based tool wherein in different places they will be collecting the failure field failures, and there will be a corrective action team, as I said. They will be doing, they will be having a committee for it, they will have a discussion on it, and they will give you the exact corrective action plan for the people. Another thing is when big industries, which for example a manufacturing industry, when they have a multiple maintenance action to be taken care in that, so you will not be knowing which engine is working properly, that engine is not working properly, and this engine has been removed from this particular jet or from this cab, car, any automotive division I am talking about. So if it is from the multiple maintenance you want to do it, so Frakas will help you out in that to identify where this particular engine has been removed from and where it has been inserted currently, and the removed particular engine is currently working or not, or it has gone bad, what all the maintenance we have to take care, or what are all the procedures of failures or for the repair we have to do for that particular engine. So likewise, we can do the analysis for that particular system. There will be a dashboard for it where it will give you which component is very much critical component or which system has to be taken care for the maintenance on priority. So likewise, we can do it on FailWeb. That is one of the advantage. So the upcoming webinars will be given shortly. So for any further information, you can just contact for www.tridentinfosol.com, aldsoftware.com, aldservices.com and fileweb.com.